Hello and welcome. My name is Noam Pianko. I'm the director of the Stroum Center for Jewish Studies and the Prezan Professor of Jewish Studies at the University of Washington. And I'm excited to welcome you today. Unfortunately, I'm having some technical issues, so I'm just here through audio and not through video, but I'm so glad to be with you nonetheless at this exciting event. Today, we have the wonderful opportunity to celebrate and learn about the newest contribution to the Samuel and Althea Stroum Endowed Lecture Series in Jewish Studies, Jonathan Israel's book, Revolutionary Jews from Spinoza to Marx. This book will join an incredibly august group of dozens of books, essays, and thought pieces in Jewish studies, including really classic texts in the field of Jewish studies, texts such as Yosef Yerushalmi's book, Zahor, Jewish History and Jewish Memory. And we are so proud to have this volume in our collection as well. This event is made possible by a collaboration with UW Press and the generous support of the community donors of the Stroum Center. And many of you are in the audience today. And on behalf of all of us, I'd just like to thank you for your generosity. I also want to thank our tremendous staff, the group of professionals at the Stroum Center who work so hard every day to bring quality, thought-provoking, and academic programming to new audiences. These professionals include Sarah Zadies Rosen, Kara Schoonmaker, Grace Elizabeth D, and Daniel Wang. For today, I also really want to thank and welcome Professor Michael Rosenthal for agreeing to moderate today's conversation with Jonathan Israel. Michael is a friend and former colleague here at the University of Washington. And Michael really was instrumental in organizing the conference in 2017 that brought Jonathan Israel and many other scholars to the University of Washington to discuss Spinoza and modern philosophy. And it is thanks to that conference that we had this Stroum lecture and now this book. And I'm very grateful, Michael, that you have agreed to join us today. So thank you for that. Professor Rosenthal, just to introduce Michael to everybody, holds the Grafstein Chair in Jewish Philosophy with appointments in both the department and the Ann Tannenbaum Center for Jewish Studies. And the event today is going to include a brief overview of the book from Jonathan Israel, and then Michael and Jonathan will have a bit of a conversation, and there will be time at the end for questions and answers as well. And in order to keep the focus on the presentation, attendees in the Zoom webinar do not have video and microphone enabled, but we welcome you to submit questions via the question and answer function at the bottom of your screen at any point during the event. So without further ado, I want to ask Michael to introduce Jonathan and to start our event. Thank you all for being here.
Yeah, thank you very much, Noam. And it's really a pleasure for me to be back at the University of Washington, where I miss many of my colleagues and especially the Center for Jewish Studies, the Stroum Center, and Professor Pianko. And thanks to all the staff for making this event possible. But let me turn now to the main speaker and introduce briefly, so we have plenty of time for conversation and discussion. The main speaker of our event, and that's Professor Jonathan Israel, who is Professor Emeritus in the School of Historical Studies at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. Jonathan, as you may know, is an incredibly well-known and recognized historian for his many works. His books include The European Jewry in the Age of Mercantilism, 1550 to 1750, Radical Enlightenment, Philosophy in the Making of Modernity. As Noam mentioned, he delivered the 2017 Stroum Lectures in Jewish Studies, which focused on Spinoza as a revolutionary thinker and the idea of the Radical Enlightenment and then the Jewish emancipation. And I'm just so pleased that he was able to complete this book to deepen and widen his reflections back in 2017, and that we have a chance to hear from him today to talk about it. So let me turn things over to Professor Israel, who'll give a brief overview of the book, and then we'll have a chance to engage in a conversation with him for a while before we turn to questions and answers. Thank you, Jonathan.
Thank you, Michael. I'd like to begin by just thanking Noam and Michael, really, for arranging the event in 2017. That's the only time I've ever been to Seattle, I regret to say, to get back there at some stage. But it was a wonderful conference which Michael organized, and the discussion was really very stimulating. And if it were not for Noam and Michael, I'm sure this book would not exist, because the idea of writing it is so closely linked to the Stroum lectures and to that occasion. So I look back on it very fondly. Well, the point of the book is to trace the early stages of the development of what you might call the modern Jewish revolutionary consciousness. After a certain point, let's say about 50 years before the Russian Revolution, from around 1870, the tendency of some Jews to adopt a revolutionary attitude, both towards government and towards churches, so towards religion and established forms of education and law, became so conspicuous, so obvious, that it was very much disapproved of course, in many quarters, but was a very well-known phenomenon on both sides of the Atlantic, of course, culminating in people like Leon Trotsky in the period just before and during the Russian Revolution. So there were many Jewish revolutionaries in the half century or so before the Russian Revolution. But what this book tries to do is to look at how this modern Jewish revolutionary consciousness emerged in the first place, and what its relationship is to the wider Jewish society, Jewish culture, Jewish tradition, because there must be deep philosophical and deep, I should say, deep historical, cultural reasons why such a phenomenon should arise and why it should become so embedded in Jewish social history. Now, I want to say that down to what I've really focused on is the period from the beginning of the Enlightenment down to the early stages of Karl Marx's life, because Marx has a very interesting development as a radical and as a revolutionary. He was certainly a revolutionary and a radical from a very early stage, but the early Marx, the revolutionary, wasn't at all a Marxist in the way we would think of Marxist today. It was nothing like being a Marxist, because he wasn't interested whatsoever in socialism until 1845 or so, till he was about 27. He took no interest whatsoever in economics, believe it or not, because we think of him as an economic theorist almost more than anything else, as an ideologist. The early stages, Marx belonged to a quite different kind of revolutionary tradition, and perhaps we'll say more about that further on. What I want to say is that the kind of oppression that the Jewish people encountered in the Russian Empire in the later 18th century, of course, it caused a lot of gloom. It was deeply resented, and that oppression was a very terrible thing. There's no question about that, and it affected the entire Jewish people in Eastern Europe in a very profound way. So how do you deal with that? I think there were basically, let's say, by the 1870s and 1880s, there were three different ways of dealing with oppression. This kind of oppression, you could you could adopt a rather passive, submissive attitude, which some people did. You could get your family and up and decide that emigration was for you the solution and go to the New World, go to America or go to Argentina or Brazil or go to South Africa or Australia. But this, remember, is only an option for significant numbers of Jews from around 1880 or the pogroms of the early 1880s. Before that, it was not really, it was not a possibility for more than a very, very tiny number. The other thing you could do is to, if you were energetic and optimistic and forward-looking, is to join one of these secrets. Of course, they were very severely repressed, so they had to operate secretly, these secret revolutionary organizations in the Russian Empire or in neighboring countries. Now, if you go by that time, by the 1870s and 80s, the last of the restrictions in other parts of Europe were disappearing, even in Hungary. Even in and certainly in countries like Switzerland, Germany, and Sweden, the old disabilities and restrictions on Jewish life were finally got rid of in the 1860s and 70s, The last of them were gone by about 1880. So you could say that Western and Central Europe had adjusted to the idea that Jews should be integrated into society and should be equal before the law and should be equal citizens with equal access to educational institutions. But so the number one thing to remember, I think, in looking at this story, which I'm trying to tell, is that that's a totally different picture from how things looked from the through the early modern period down to the early 19th century, let's say down to the time that Marx was a young man. So throughout that period, quite serious restrictions down to the early 19th century, they were still really rather serious restrictions on Jewish life applied right across Central and parts of Western Europe as well, and even parts of the New World. Remember, until the 1830s, even in the United States, which was the freest of all the Western countries since the American Revolution, since the 1770s and 80s, but even in the United States, down to the 1830s, people sometimes forget this, that many states, I know Pennsylvania is a good example, but actually a particularly good example, but most because there was a protest from the Jewish community of Philadelphia about this, which was rejected in 1783, the last year before the end of the Revolutionary War, many state constitutions did not allow any person to take up public office or become a representative in the state assembly unless they were willing to swear on the divine status of the New Testament as well as the Old, which Jews, of course, couldn't do. And it was designed was supposed to be designed to exclude atheists and deists, but it, of course, also was designed to exclude the Jews too. So even in the United States, there were certain restrictions, and the blasphemy laws were quite tough. So if you criticized the churches in a way that some people didn't like, it could get you into a lot of trouble. Before the early 19th century, it was much worse than that. So in the 17th and 18th centuries, you had a lot of restrictions and European life was quite oppressive. Even in the freest continental European country, which was Holland, the Netherlands had a great reputation because you had more freedom of expression, you could publish books more easily, you could criticize the government to some extent, you could even criticize the dominant church to some extent, as long as you didn't. One thing that was against the law was to deny the divinity of Christ. So as long as you didn't say that the doctrine of the Trinity is nonsense, which quite a lot of Christians in the Netherlands did believe, there were a lot of Socinians and Unitarians who didn't think that that Christ was divine. They thought Christ was a man. They thought Christianity was the right religion, and Christianity has a very precious moral core and role to perform in the world, but they did not think Christ was divine. But you were not allowed to say or publish. That could get you into prison. You had to be, depends where you said it. In Amsterdam, you'd get away with it as long as you didn't do it too flagrantly. It had to be in sort of semi-clandestine. Okay, but there were much worse restrictions than that. In the Netherlands, for example, even in Holland, a very good instance would be the guild system. Down to the 19th century or the early 19th century, the guilds more or less excluded the Jews from nearly all crafts and nearly all economic activities apart from trade, overseas trade, financial things, the things that they, traditional restrictions had squeezed them into. And there were many parts of Europe until the middle of the 19th century. Papal Rome would be a good example. Jewish life was very severely restricted and oppressed in Rome. And in other parts of Italy as well. And until the 1830s, you still had the Inquisition operating in Spanish-speaking countries and in the Spanish New World. So there was plenty of oppression on all sides, and it was greatly resented and it greatly restricted Jewish life. So, and since immigration was not really a major option, it was a major option, especially if you needed to escape the Inquisition. You could get away from Portugal or Spain and you could get to Holland or England or Hamburg, which was a relatively free city. But even that actually was an option only for relatively small numbers of people. You wouldn't be able to escape without leaving a lot of your possessions behind and suffering, in many cases at least, suffering quite severe losses. So the restrictions on Jewish life everywhere really were very, even in England, even down to the 1870s, Oxford and Cambridge still excluded Jews from higher education. So that was quite a big restriction, which was much resented. If it were not for the beginnings of the University of London in the late 1820s, which was set up by one of these radical Enlightenment figures, Jeremy Bentham, who was privately anti-Christian. You were not allowed, of course, without destroying your own career and reputation, you couldn't come out and say that publicly. But there were, of course, a lot of influential anti-Christians around, and Bentham is a good example of one, who were determined to change all this. And there were many, many changes, one of which was the beginnings of the University of London, which deliberately didn't have a theology department, and from the beginning was always open. We want no theology here. And the Catholics, who were another discriminated against group in Britain in the 19th century, Catholics and Jews can be students at the new University of London on an equal basis with everyone else. That's something that doesn't get going till around 1830, which is quite late after all. And that means that until 1830, higher education, not in England, is for Jews, is shut. You don't have access. You can't study, you can't get degrees there. Okay, so the restrictions are very great. Emigration is not really a solution. What do you do? So this, I think I've set the scene in a way which shows why a certain kind of enlightenment, particularly the more radical forms of enlightenment that wanted to change the whole political, not just make society more tolerant, but change the whole legal structure, the whole educational structure, drastically reduce the power of the churches so that they couldn't perform such an obstructive role as they had in the past, as far as most Jews were concerned, and it really changed the framework of society as well as the legal status of the Jews. So Jewish emancipation depended on enlightenment. You cannot separate Jewish emancipation in the modern world from enlightenment. But the more moderate kinds of enlightenment that wanted to compromise, let's say, with the existing legal structures, the existing political structures, and with the churches, and say, okay, you know, we want to leave church influence over education, for example, over the law, pretty strong. We need a few changes, but let's leave church influence pretty strong over education. And we're not that interested in the Jews anyway, which would be very much the attitude of Voltaire or Montesquieu or David Hume, that they weren't. So only certain kinds of enlighteners who were prepared to go much further, like John Toland, for example, who was the first in 1714 to publish a pamphlet in England saying, the Jews are the same as everybody else, let's integrate them into society on the same basis as everybody else. It's quite an important thing in 1714. But that's connected with his opposition, his sweeping comprehensive opposition to the entire institutional, educational, and religious structure in Britain. So you can see from what I've said, or at least I hope so, that this is at least reasonably persuasive, that for Jews, especially after the disappointments of the great, there was one other possibility, which I didn't mention, of release from oppression. Getting out of the prison. There was one other thing that greatly appealed to vast numbers of people in the late 17th century and down to the middle of the 18th century. The messianic movement of Sabbatai Zvi, which many listeners will know something about, 1665, 1666. The Messiah has come. Divine intervention is here. The redemption of the Jews is at hand. Everything is going to change, and everything is going to be much better. And the prison the prison gates are going to be thrown open, and the day of liberation is here. Well, that's wonderful. And people were enormously excited in 1660. The trouble with that solution is it didn't work and nothing happened. There was another bout of messianism in the 1750s, in especially in Poland, the movement of Jakob Frank, which may come up in the discussion later, but that didn't work either. So the messianic possibility, by arousing a lot of excitement, actually was counterproductive in a way for those that believed in miracles and in divine intervention, because there weren't any miracles and there wasn't any divine intervention. So in the long run, the messianic movement was deeply disappointing. And I think it only added to the pressure, the tendency to make a deeply rationalizing, philosophical and radical kind of enlightenment appealing to large numbers of the more educated element, or those that were able to get access to books in French and German in particular. I think those are the two languages that mattered most among the modern languages for this purpose, and opened up this whole new process and this whole new phase in Jewish history. Now, how that worked out in more detail in terms of the intellectual and philosophical consequences of this process, which I've tried to set the scene for, I hope will emerge from the discussion. So perhaps without more ado, I can end the setting the scene part of the discussion this afternoon there, and hand over to Michael to steer the more specific discussion of different thinkers and writers and different elements in the book.
Great, thank you, Jonathan. That's a great introduction. Let me just start with, I have a bunch of questions and hopefully we'll hit on some of the themes and also give you a chance to raise some of your own issues if I miss something that you want to emphasize about the book. But let me start with something kind of personal. And I noticed in the preface, you dedicate the book to a friend of yours, another historian. But you mentioned that you both had a teacher in high school, Walter Isaacson, that inspired you in some ways. So I found it very interesting in this point in your long and very distinguished career as an historian, that you came back to someone who inspired you in some ways at the very beginning of it. So maybe could you just say a little bit about your motivation behind writing this book? And how?
Yeah, I think that like many other people, I feel that my life was very, very strongly redirected as a teenager by one particular teacher. I think one particular teacher can change one's life quite fundamentally. And as an early teenager, I think I was a bit of a slow coach, not doing very well in school. Wasn't all that excited by schoolwork either. I was doing a bit better by the time I got to 16 or 17, but I was still only vaguely in the middle of the class at best, I think. But then meeting Walter Isaacson, he was a refugee from Nazi Germany. He'd been a young lecturer at Marburg, I believe, when the Jews were all Jewish teachers and civil servants, of course, were forced to leave their positions. And eventually, quite late, I think, it's not till 1938 that he actually left Germany and moved to London and became a Latin teacher at Kilburn Grammar School, a secondary school, which is where I attended in the 1960s. And he was always, I think, more interested in history of philosophy than history as such. So he turned his general history lessons often into discussions of Kant and Hegel. And I got quite intoxicated with this, even if I couldn't make much sense of it at first. I remember my father, who was a businessman, I was talking excitedly about this teacher one evening, putting his tired from work, and he put his newspaper down very impatiently and said, "Okay, well, explain Hegel's philosophy to me then." And I was completely stumped for a moment. But that didn't dampen my excitement, not at all. And so he had a very inspiring effect, Walter Isaacson. And he had a sense that certain pupils were able to respond to the kind of thing he could teach them. And he enjoyed very much coaching a small group for the Oxford and Cambridge admission exams, I don't think there's any chance that I would have been. I won an open scholarship at Cambridge as an 18-year-old and took up that scholarship in 1964. And I'm absolutely certain that if it was not for this teacher, I would never have been in a position to have that opportunity. So from that point on, I felt that I had that I even had an advantage over others because of him. So it certainly had a tremendous impact, yes.
Great. Let's get into the substance of the book. You begin, maybe not so surprisingly, with Spinoza. So why? Isn't he someone who was a heretic and banned from the Jewish community? In what sense do you begin a book on Jewish revolutionary thinkers with Spinoza? And in some ways also, I think, which would also interest the audience, I think, a lot would be, in what way does his Sephardic background matter to the development of his thought and the theme of the book? Maybe a supplementary question as well.
Yeah, well, two very, very pertinent questions. Well, the first thing to remember, I think, is that the Portuguese Jewish community in Amsterdam in the middle of the 17th century were not only faced by the problem of Spinoza, and of course, after a certain point, they got fed up with his defiant attitude and expelled him in July, put him under the permanent ban of the Kherim in July 1656. But they were having trouble with a number of other Sephardics. The others were mostly people who had recently arrived from the peninsula and were not necessarily, that they were convinced that they were absolutely fed up with the Catholic Church and the Inquisition, but that didn't necessarily mean that they were won over to Orthodox Judaism. So we do know that in the middle and late 1650s, Spinoza was not just an individual, but part of a group. And that is really the beginning of the story, because we know quite a lot about particularly Juan de Prado, who was another one of these groups. So we also, we know less so far, but research is being done. We will know more about a man called Daniel Ribera and one or two others. So they were facing the, let's say, an anti-rabbinic, anti-orthodox revolt, which was followed along the lines a little bit of Uriel da Costa, who many of those listening to this discussion will know the name Uriel da Costa in the early 17th century, who was another refugee from the Inquisition in Portugal. He went to Hamburg first before he came to Holland. But now Uriel da Costa didn't have any doubts that the Catholic Church and the Inquisition were very oppressive and very evil and felt deeply resentful about that. But he wasn't so convinced by the rabbis either. And in fact, he couldn't quite work out, since his idea of Judaism, he started piecing things together, mainly from reading Latin books or Latin versions of the Old Testament and Latin versions of accounts of Judaism in ancient times. And he couldn't quite see what modern Orthodox Jewry, how that followed on in many cases from what he thought Judaism ought to be about from his deductions from reading ancient texts in Latin. So there was an intellectual problem, you might say. Actually, one or two other Sephardic writers mentioned this, that newcomers from the Iberian Peninsula, in most cases, recognizing that they were new to normative Judaism, were respectful and submissive. Unfortunately, there were certain arrogant types, often, and I think this is true, he says it's often connected with their being physicians or for some other reason having, as new Christians, of course, there was no barrier to their going to university. So there's one way in which these refugees from the Inquisition in Spain and Portugal had an advantage in a debate about religion or about politics or society with Christians that other Jews didn't have. And that is, they had Western university degrees and were highly literate in Latin, as well as their vernacular language, which in their case would be Spanish or Portuguese, but was often French as well. Many of them had spent periods in France. So the rabbis in Holland in the middle of the 17th century recognized that there was a social cultural problem, that these refugees normally were very receptive and let's say, passive learners in the hands of the rabbis. But there was a hard core of real exceptions to this. Nearly always people who had university degrees and knew a lot more Latin than the rabbis did, read a lot of books. And Orobio de Castro, for example, who's one of the physicians who went to Holland, says these people were often intellectually very confident, not to say arrogant, and they didn't necessarily accept what the rabbis told them. And so you had a real intellectual cultural problem, which showed itself in Hamburg, in Holland. And I think you can see this very clearly from the history of the Sephardics in London and in Bevis Marx community as well. So it's a much wider problem than just Spinoza. And I think it's not surprising when you think of this background that to answer your second question, why the Sephardics begin this process more than Ashkenazic Jews, because the Ashkenazic Jews had much less access to Western higher education and Latin than the Sephardics. The Sephardics had this hardcore of university trained Latin reading intellectuals, often physicians, like Juan de Prado, who was Spinoza's closest ally in Amsterdam in the 1650s, and that these people were, and there's another important psychological factor, I think, and intellectual factor, and that is that most rabbis in Germany, Poland, Russia, the Czech lands, and so on, in the Ashkenazic world, felt that the as did the community elders, the elders governing the Jewish communities, that the best defensive mechanism, the best way to ensure Jewish survival and stability under the conditions they had to live, was to be very submissive to authority and never to challenge. They might sometimes be forced into disputations, which they were very reluctant to join, to participate in, but never to challenge Christian arguments and belief. You don't do that if you any regard for your own safety. But these people are fleeing the Inquisition with university degrees, and they hate Christianity. They detest it in an intellectual way, which is very different from the attitude of rabbis in Ashkenazic Europe, very different. I mean, Uriel da Costa, I believe Spinoza in his own way, Juan de Prado certainly, and a lot of other Sephardic Jews in the late 17th century, Elijah Montalto, who spent a lot of time in France, would be an excellent example of this, are so fierce and so vehement in their anti-Christianity. Admittedly, they can't publish any of their texts, but they write manuscripts which are carefully kept secret, especially in Amsterdam. There was a whole collection of them in the Eitz Chaim Library in Amsterdam, that eventually, when European non-Jewish free thinkers discovered the existence of these manuscripts, Anthony Collins and John Toland are very good examples here, especially Collins, who was particularly interested in these manuscripts, and arranged for and several French free thinkers in the early 18th century also arranged the translation, usually into French, actually, the translation from, they were written normally in Spanish or Portuguese, these clandestine anti-Christian texts that were kept secret. They were then, these free thinkers who are not Jewish then arranged for their translation into French. And then through the 18th century, they begin to diffuse. And you can see how they have quite a big significant input, for example, into the work of the Baron Dolbach would be a good instance of somebody who was interested in this kind of thing and absorbed quite a lot. So these extremely dismissive arguments against Christianity, which absolutely don't come from an Ashkenazic background but Sephardic background, play a large part in the beginnings and in the evolution of this type of radical enlightenment, both in its non-Jewish aspects and in its Jewish aspects.
Great. One thing that I was really amazed by in your Stroum lectures back in 2017 was the discussion about these revolutionary Jews living in the New World in various ways, both in kind of south in Suriname and also in the American colonies. You point out, I think in the book, that there were only about 2,000 Jews out of a population of 2.5 million in the Americas. Just in the United States, in the colonial, yeah. In the part. Well, I have another follow-up question in a minute after this about the kind of David Nassi and the Caribbean Enlightenment. But how were Jews in North America involved, even though they were tiny, why were they involved and how were they involved in the kind of revolutionary movement that you're describing?
Very small groups, and you might think that their role couldn't have been very significant, but I think it does have a certain significance. And the reason for that is that they, especially in Charleston and in Savannah, in the southern states, where there were very important, often Sephardic Jewish communities, not only they were mixed Sephardic Ashkenazic communities, but also in Newport, Rhode Island, and in New York, had pretty strong links with the Caribbean area. And the Caribbean played quite a big role in the American Revolution because there wasn't much under British rule until 1775, certain things weren't produced to any great degree in North America. There wasn't much in the way of producing things like artillery, for example, or artillery shells and certain kinds of guns and certain naval munitions would be another example. Where were you going to get naval supplies from? They weren't so used to that. There were certain other things that were very important in American life, interestingly, in particular Bibles, because you couldn't get them from England once the war started and you needed lots of Bibles. So they tended to come from Holland as well. Now, many of these things that were suddenly in short supply could be provided from Holland, which was still a very major trade depot, and the Dutch had colonies in the Caribbean, and several of these colonies, Curaçao, but particularly the island of St. Eustatius, until it got attacked by Admiral Rodney and the British, who got so fed up with this and were so aware of the role, because the British say this a number of times, that the Dutch and Dutch Jews, the Jews in particular, they blame for this, were one of the main providers of the munitions and supplies and other things that the Americans lacked, and that they were considered a tremendous nuisance. The British Navy launched a full-scale attack on St. Eustatius, took over the island, I think that was in 1781, if I remember the date correctly, and expelled the entire Jewish community with 200 or 300 people. They were told they had 48 hours to leave, and they lost all their stuff. And there was the questions about this were raised in Parliament by Edmund Burke later, but it was a long remembered episode. And in fact, it's also mentioned by the Philadelphia community when they in 1783 when they complained to the state legislature of Pennsylvania, "You're not letting us, we're not eligible to be members of the state legislature. We're not eligible to take up public office because of this restriction that bars us. And yet we've contributed in a very significant way to the success of the revolution. Look what St. Eustatius did." The British completely so infuriated that they launched a full-scale attack on the island. And the reply was, "Well, that's just too bad. We're not changing the rules." But so I think it was quite widely known. It became quite widely known that the Caribbean had played this role.
Yeah. I mean, so let me ask a question about David Nassi. Hmm. And so you talk about the role of what you called the Caribbean Enlightenment, which is a very interesting idea. I mean, can you tell us something about that and about the life and role of David Nassi, who lived mostly in Suriname? I mean, you write about how he proposed that one of the Caribbean islands, or at least he follows a suggestion of someone else in France, I think, that a Caribbean island be made into a homeland of the Jews where they could finally...
actually Diderot. Diderot who suggests this in the Histoire philosophique, that an island can be found.
Yeah, and they could rule themselves in this kind of enlightened state, a vision of Zionism, of en la lettre or something.
Something like that, yes.
I'm just curious, like, maybe say a little bit about that. That was an incredible
text. Well, I think there was, Voltaire discusses it in one place, the Histoire philosophique, as Diderot and his friends discuss it, certainly in 1770. It attracted a certain amount of interest that... in Suriname, going back to the late 17th century, ever since the middle of the 17th century, in fact, since the 1650s, the Jews enjoyed a more or less complete local autonomy. They had their own little town called Jodensavanne, and they were just left to run their own affairs, more or less. And although they, as like in the United States, they after the revolution, they were not allowed to take up public office, and they couldn't be part of the governor's council, because if you wouldn't swear by the New Testament, you couldn't. Nevertheless, they had a level of autonomy and freedom in Suriname which went beyond anything seen in Europe. And the enlighteners like Diderot and D'Holbach and Voltaire, to some extent, were very interested in this phenomenon. And so it sort of crops up in a number of curious contexts in 18th century Enlightenment literature. It kind of was a reminder that the extremely cramped and restricted conditions forced into a very narrow set of economic roles, which characterized Jewish life in Europe, was something imposed on the Jews. It was not something, I think most people would have, until before the Enlightenment, would have just thought, well, Jews, they're people who live in these cramped corners and have a very restricted range of economic roles in society. It's only with the Enlightenment, I think Tolland is actually the first writer to say that there's absolutely no reason why the Jews shouldn't be farmers and doing just about everything, doing everything that everyone else does. It's just that they're prevented from doing so by the oppressive conditions under which they live. That's a very important argument in Tolland's pamphlet of 1714, which I mentioned before. And I think that this phenomenon of the Jews being agriculturalists, of being free more or less to do whatever they want and to run their own town, was rather fascinating for enlighteners in the 18th century. So that, although the it was not a large community by the standards of Jewish population elsewhere, it was not much more in the 18th century. It was not a great deal more than sort of 1,500 or something like that. Maybe it was 2,000 at times, but I don't think it ever got beyond around 2,000. So it was quite a small number of people in a way, but it was a very large proportion of the white population in Suriname at that time. In fact, it was probably about half, because I think the rest, the Protestant and Catholic population was probably not significantly larger, I think, in Suriname than the Jewish population. So this is the other thing, the idea that the Jews are not a sort of some small minority who's squeezed into a corner, but, you know, have a large role in society, which included in military functions, by the way. There was a lot of interest in that, especially in Holland later, and through the Enlightenment period, that there was no reason why Jews shouldn't be soldiers and shouldn't help guard the forts and so on. And when the Netherlands found itself again at war with England in the 1780s, in the Fourth Anglo-Dutch War, in Curaçao, in Suriname, in other Caribbean colonies, this is really the first time in modern history that the Jews in significant numbers are performing military roles alongside Christians. That had never happened before.
So let me kind of step back from a particular case and ask you a kind of broader question that kind of comes up from the book. And you talk about what you call the Jewish impulse to self-emancipate. But you also talk, you just were describing the various ways in which many Jews at least did accept a kind of a submissive role in regard to society. Didn't imagine that their world could be otherwise. So is this idea of self-emancipation, which becomes increasingly important with the Enlightenment, is this something new, do you think, thanks to Spinoza and the Enlightenment? Or is it something that has roots in Jewish history and thought more that go farther back that are kind of, is it, so to what extent is this itself a revolutionary change, or is this part of a continuity that relates to the Jewish tradition in some way, do you think?
Well, there certainly is an ancient Jewish tradition, of course, of military valor and defending the ancient Israelite Republic and so on, which was in a certain sense familiar to all Jews because they're reading the Torah and they're reading the other books of the Old Testament. Right. So they know about the, everybody knows about the Maccabean revolt, to give a very obvious example. So it's there lodged in their consciousness, undoubtedly. And indeed, Spinoza mentions this. He said, right. I think in that famous passage, there's a famous passage in the Tractatus Theologico Politicus where Spinoza says, if the Jews ever recover their courage, he wouldn't exclude the possibility that someday they might be able to establish their own state again. And I think, although that's arguably a slightly sarcastic remark, because he doesn't think, I think it is partly a sarcastic remark. He's commenting on the fact that the Jews have lost the prowess that they once had. But he's also reminding people that if they had that prowess once before, it's not inconceivable they might get it back again somehow at some future point. And I think that he's making a double point, really, that the Jews are not in a position to achieve this as things stand. But you can't entirely exclude that possibility in the future. So I think that's a very interesting thing. But I when we talk about Spinoza's influence, let me say at this point, because I think it's a very important aspect of the book. I do think there are two different senses in which the old idea that Spinoza was completely ignored in his own time and afterwards and had very little influence, which you can still see in some books, even down to the 1970s and 80s. Some scholars are still saying this, that until the 1780s, till the big controversy that arose around Lessing and Mendelssohn, the so-called Pantheismus Streit in the 1780s, that the very little attention was paid to Spinoza and so on. This is, of course, total nonsense, as I've been arguing for many years now, and it's completely unhistorical. That's totally untrue. But it's totally untrue in two different ways. Firstly, there is Spinoza, the philosopher and writer of texts, who was definitely not ignored, and there was a very strong reaction to Spinoza, the philosopher, and his texts. But in addition to that, there's also the myth of Spinoza, who becomes a kind of, well, there are two myths of Spinoza. One is this sort of noble-minded figure who lives very modestly, who doesn't seek position or money, and sets a moral example to others. But I think during the Enlightenment, just, and this gets much less attention, but historically it's arguably more important. I think it's less attention because it's not so closely linked to the Spinoza the person and Spinoza the thinker, perhaps, than the other myth. And it's more of a creation by especially early 18th century French free thinkers, the most famous of whom was the Marquis d'Argens, who became very important later at the court of Frederick the Great. But during the 1730s, having had terrible rows with his family and with the Catholic priests in southern France, where he came from, was living in Holland, writing books in French. And in these books, he was very anti-Christian. He was very sympathetic towards the Jews and especially to Jewish arguments against Christians. And he wrote very extensively. And although there's not much interest in the Marquis d'Argens today, his books were widely read in the 1730s and 40s. And in two of them, this is, I think, a good example of the point I'm trying to make here, in the Lettres Juives and in the Lettres Chinoises, which is perhaps a more surprising instance, in the Lettres Chinoises, Chinese visitors do a tour of Europe. and being extremely sensible and extremely rational, these Chinese visitors have a very long list of criticisms to make of European society, European education. Just about everything they see seems irrational, silly, badly structured, unjust, and defective in just about every way you can think of. And on almost every page, Darshan is telling you that these Chinese visitors are sending letters back, supposedly, to their relatives in China, and constantly mention, but there is one sensible philosopher whose name is Spinoza. And we're told again and again how Spinoza's ideas cancel out all this nonsense and would replace it with a much more rational system. So, some historians don't accept this argument. So there's a bit of a controversy going on about this, but I don't think their arguments are very good ones, if I may say so. Spinozism as a, let's call it Darshan Spinozism, so we've got something very specific in mind, although there are many other French free thinkers in the early 18th century who are repeating this kind of stuff. But Spinozist and Spinozism is mentioned again and again and again and again. It's a central theme of this of the period from about 1710 to 1750, when Voltaire and Montesquieu were young. And it is a central strand of the Enlightenment. And I think nobody reading French growing up in the second or third quarter of the 18th century could possibly not have an idea of Spinozism as the great alternative to the way things are, because that's just, you know, this is hammered into French libertine culture during that period. If you look at Darshan's books, you will very quickly see what I'm getting at, how Spinozism is seen as a kind of solution to a world of misery. Most people are living unhappy lives. The chains of oppression are on all sides. How do we escape from tyranny and prejudice and priestcraft and general oppression? Well, the answer is Spinozism. So I think this is not a very difficult theme for anyone to latch onto who's around at that particular time in history.
I want to ask you a little bit, again, another kind of historiographical question, but I think one that is at the heart of your argument in the book. And that's, maybe you can say something about the relationship between what you call the kind of general Enlightenment, the Jewish Enlightenment or the Haskalah, and then what you distinguish that as the kind of the Spinozistically inspired radical Jewish Enlightenment. And maybe, I know it's a very broad theme, but maybe to kind of focus this question maybe on particular figures, maybe you could say something about the project. So this is right after the period you were just discussing. So this is like the 1750, second half of the 18th century. What was the project of Jewish reformers like Moses Mendelssohn and Krochmal? What was wrong with it from the point of view of the radicals?
Yeah. Haskalah, what you might call the mainstream Haskalah, the Haskalah that the Jewish Enlightenment of Moses Mendelssohn or Krochmal is an attempt to, and I think the beginnings of it go back to an earlier stage. I mean, you can see already, for example, in the early 17th century, in Elijah del Medigo of Crete, a very interesting Jewish writer of the early 17th century, that there's a whole tradition of, Del Medico's status with Orthodox rabbis was already a little bit tense or dodgy. In fact, he had to leave Holland in 1629, somewhat under a cloud, because he was complaining, I think, particularly about two things. And let's say there are three good elements in his critique of Jewish Orthodoxy, as let's say of the early or middle 17th century. And this would apply very much, I think, to the Haskalah of Mendelssohn. Firstly, the Jewish rabbinical grip on Jewish education was having the effect of closing off Jewish youth from science and the latest developments. Del Medigo was particularly interested in the example of Galilean astronomy. If we don't keep up with the latest science, if we are stuck in medieval notions of science, that is a tremendous disadvantage culturally to young people, and it's a barrier to the pursuit of truth and wisdom. So there's a complaint about that we're being cut off from the sciences, that the rabbis exercise a censorship which is too strict, that they're not allowing enough scope for people to express their views and to express criticism. And that they should be more leeway for debate. And Belmedica was very interested in discussion with the Karaites, the medieval Jewish heresy, which most Orthodox rabbis in early modern times and still in the 18th century reacted to the Karaites in a purely negative way, simply rejecting their opposition to Talmudic additions to the rules and laws and observances of Judaism as set out in the Torah. Not so much in the Talmud, but the Karaites are complaining about rabbinic interpretations and additions since, let's say, the 9th or 10th century. And whereas Belmedico felt, they've got a few points which are worth listening to. We should have constructive discussions with Karaites. So in these respects, there was already quite a lot of tension between what you might call an incipient Jewish Enlightenment and strict rabbinic orthodoxy. So Mendelssohn wanted to reform Jewish education above all, as did his colleagues and allies. They wanted to modernize the teaching of Hebrew, make it more grammatical, look at other languages also. They wanted Jewish youth to learn other languages besides Yiddish and Hebrew so that they could read books in other languages. They wanted to broaden horizons, to learn more science, and they wanted more debate and discussion and less censorship. And this modernizing, broadening tendency, the mainstream Jewish Enlightenment very quickly provoked the opposition, especially in Poland and in Prague, of Orthodox rabbis who simply opposed what they were doing. So there's an opposition between Jewish orthodoxy and Haskalah, really from, which is incipiently there already in the 17th century and can be indeed connected with the episode I was talking about before, Spinoza and De Prado. So I don't think it's something totally new. But Mendelssohn also, and his closest allies like Vesely and others, were very anxious not to be too divisive or to create very deep rifts within the Jewish people. And so they went out of their way, I think, to, not very successfully, it has to be said in the long run, but they went out of their way to maintain a harmony, compromise, and at least a working relationship with Jewish orthodoxy so as not to create a complete break. But as always happens in these situations, there are a few people who go off in a more extreme way and don't accept this need to for compromise and for harmonization. And so in around Mendelssohn, of course, broke with Solomon Maimon, for example, who is one of the people I discuss in the book, because Maimon, who actually grew up in a Lithuanian shtetl and went to a cheder where he found, which he describes in his famous autobiography, Solomon Maimon's Lebensgeschichte, or autobiography, is one of the great Jewish books of the late 18th century. But it gives you an extremely negative picture of what standard Jewish education in Eastern Europe was like in the late 18th century. Not very attractive, very narrow, and very censorious. So, and you know, for him, yes, the Jews are suffering oppression. They live in a kind of gigantic prison, but they're also mini prisons which are run by the elders and the rabbis of the Jewish communities themselves, who created another kind of an oppression within an oppression. This is how Maimon saw it, which also has to be, which we also need liberation and emancipation from. I have to say, actually, one point of connection between Maimon and those followers of Sabbatai Zvi and Jacob Frank that I mentioned before is that it's quite clear when you look at the history of the Sabbatian movement and the Frankist movement that they wanted liberation not only from the oppression around them, but liberation also from Orthodox rabbis and from a too restrictive and constricting a Jewish lifestyle and observance. I mean, one of the first things they do is to throw Orthodox Jewish observance out of the window, which is why they were regarded with such abhorrence by Orthodox rabbis.
I want to talk the next two questions, a couple of questions. I want to get to Marx, hopefully by the end of our time here. But I want to ask two questions about two revolutions. One is the French Revolution, and then the revolution, the failed revolutions of 1848. The revolutionary period at the end of the 18th century, obviously a lot was at stake for Jews. I mean, you know, you're talking about the kind of intellectual background, then something really changes. The French Revolution emancipates the Jews in France, and then it's Napoleon who extends this model through the wars of conquest, at least to parts of Germany and elsewhere. So we get the beginning of kind of real political emancipation of Jews in Europe. And at the beginning of your discussion of this period in the book, you mention Arthur Herzberg's thesis that modern anti-Semitism was not really directed at the French Revolution, but to some extent as a reaction to it, but in fact, to some extent was a product of the revolution. And that's a thesis with which modern anti-Semitism in some ways begins with the French Revolution, which seems like kind of very paradoxical kind of claim. And you said to some extent you agree with it. Can you say a little bit about that? I mean, about the tensions within the project of political Jewish emancipation, the sense in which it really did open up opportunities for Jews and maybe at the same time made things more difficult for them in new ways?
Yeah. Well, remember, let's go back to the Enlightenment for a moment. If you are, I said that the moderate mainstream Enlightenment, partly because it's, Voltaire would be a good example here. He said, we cannot succeed if we alienate all the established authorities. We want to weaken the position of the churches. We want a more tolerant society, but then we have to be allied with the courts, with the princes and kings, with the aristocracy. So these radical enlighteners, like the Baron d'Holbach, for example, who he thought were completely on the wrong track, or Condorcet during the French Revolution, who was young when a young man, but already doing his stuff when Voltaire died, and many others, by attacking not only the churches, but all the kings, the aristocrats, the whole educational system, the whole legal system, they're going much too far. And Voltaire thought an enlightenment like that could never succeed. And that was the enlightenment that the French revolutionaries were after. But not all of them. There were deep divisions within the French Revolution, remember. Some revolutionaries adopted a much more moderate line from the point of view of kings or the churches. And then others were much more Rousseauistic. There are really three different ideologies, I've argued, in the French Revolution. So one would be the revolutionary version of the moderate mainstream Enlightenment. One would be the revolutionary version of the radical Enlightenment. But in addition to that, you have and they use Rousseau as their cult figure and as their icon. But the Robespierres, or the followers of Marat, like sort of stirring up the less literate and the less well-informed part of the population with very simplistic notions, or actually quite often with outright lies. They acquire a lot of power by manipulating mobs in the streets. And they're very keen on Rousseau's idea that the general will should not be understood as a set of things which are good for the population as a whole, as defined by philosophers, which is how Diderot or Condorcet or Destutt de Tracy or Volney and other revolutionary leaders who follow in this radical Enlightenment tradition would understand the general will. The general will is what is best for the largest number in terms as defined by reason. What they much preferred to that was Rousseau's idea that the general will should be defined as what most of the population want as a collective. And even if it's a majority bullying the minority, well, it's still a good thing if most people want it. So of course, Robespierre was quite happy to go along with that. And a lot of the more despotic and tyrannical aspects of the French Revolution are connected with this. And it is that aspect, I think, which is why one or two of the Jewish revolutionaries that I've discussed in the book, who are not very well known in some cases, deserve to be better known precisely because of their very interesting ideological role in this context. A good example would be Junius Fry, for instance, whom most people listening to this discussion perhaps haven't never even heard of Fry. He's not very well known. A lot of books on the French Revolution don't even have him in the index. But he was quite a prominent figure for a while in Paris, although he came from Austria, or from Moravia more specifically, and he came from a Frankist family, which is interesting. And apart from his political activities, which I won't go into now, but he was a very active revolutionary in 1792, 93, 94, until he was guillotined by Robespierre in 1794. But in 1793, he produced a book of political theory, which is hardly ever discussed anywhere, which is entitled Philosophie Sociale, Social Philosophy. And it has a number of very interesting aspects to it. And one of them is its very strong anti-Rousseauism, precisely on the point I just mentioned. He's saying that this Rousseau's conception of general will is not a true philosopher's conception of general will. And it's a very dangerous one that can easily be used by despots. So it was quite prescient in that way. And the very next year, he himself was a victim of that despotism.
Right. Let's turn a little bit now to the next revolution. I mean, in a way, you talk about 1848 as an important marker, and you talk about in the 19th century and before then, there were revolutionaries that wanted a kind of broader emancipation in the sense that they wanted restrictions on Jewish life to be finally eliminated. But then after the revolution of 1848, you get, I mean, my sense is a different kind of Marxist framework in which there's the Jewish problem becomes a symptom of oppression. And the revolution involves not the preservation or the reform or the reinvention of Jewish life, but really the dissolution of Jewish life in service of a new order. Is that too simple, this kind of pre and post 1848 thing? I mean, were there Marxists, either Marx himself, who didn't want to abolish Judaism as a product of, as part of the revolution?
So I didn't quite follow the last part of your question. What do you mean, who didn't want to?
Well, so were there Marxists who didn't want to abolish Judaism, who believed, for example, that it should be maintained in some form of a new order?
Ah, I see what you mean. Yeah. No, I think that one of the interesting things about the revolutionaries that I've been describing in the period down to, let's say, the generation before Marx, is that mostly they do see the continuance or the reform of Jewish life, the continuance of Jewish collective life as an identity, but now in a very different way from in the past, and in a much more open and liberal way than in the past, as something, as a goal worth pursuing and as a valuable objective to keep in mind. So even somebody, figure in the French Revolution that I talk about quite a lot in the book, Salkind Hurwitz, or the most prominent Ashkenazic Jewish revolutionary in Holland, in the 1790s, a man called Hartog Limon. They are certainly not, they are very much at odds with the rabbis. They are very much critical of many aspects of Jewish orthodoxy, but they're not rejecting either Judaism or the Jewish people, and they are very, quite the contrary, they are trying to reform and reconfigure Jewish life in a completely new context. A bit like later on, say, Emma Goldman would in the early stages of the Russian Revolution, that she's a thoroughgoing revolutionary in every way, but she's not rejecting the Jewish people. She's trying to resolve the difficulties of Jewish life and renew and reorganize Jewish life at the same time. So I think that the kind of roots, I'm not saying that, of course, before the French Revolution, there were also Jews who were quite willing to totally abandon and have nothing more to do with their Jewish heritage, just as is the case with Karl Marx or with Leon Trotsky later. Certainly there are, but I see as a less, certainly amongst those revolutionaries who made a mark and who I've described in the book, although there are one or two I couldn't discover very much about, so it may be true of them. But I think in the main, not many of the figures had cut themselves off from Jewish life in every way, in the way that, say, Karl Marx, culturally and psychologically, in the way that Marx and Trotsky did. So I think Marxism greatly, remember, I see Marx as two different people, if you like, or two different stages. This doesn't apply to the early Marx, although his attitude to Judaism is probably already marked as an early man, early on in his life. And he's certainly rejecting his Jewish heritage. So I think that Marxism, by saying that, by redefining everything in terms of economic class and in terms of the proletariat and the role of the bourgeoisie, by redefining history itself and social development in terms of class warfare and the way that Marx does, I think he erases Jewish identity and Jewish culture as a significant factor. And if you look at the proliferating number of East European Jewish revolutionaries, let's say in the 1880s and 90s, some are Marxists, and the Marxists tend to be rejecting their Jewish heritage completely. But others are not Marxists. They're either, I'm not quite sure what you'd call Emma Goldman, but she's an anarchist revolutionary of a non-Marxist type, although she's in dialogue with Marxists. Mm-hmm. but there are a lot of examples of other Jewish revolutionaries who are in part also Zionists. They're very emphatic on the value. This is actually a bit like Spinoza himself, who rejects rabbinic Judaism but loves Hebrew. So several of these revolutionaries not only love Hebrew and Yiddish, but they want to, and they're not only trying to retain Jewish identity, but they want to improve understanding and knowledge reform and invigorate modern Hebrew, and they want to, following on from Moses Hess, I think they're also very interested in the renewal of Jewish society, perhaps in the Holy Land. So the beginnings of Zionism can be clearly seen, I think, in the period between the late Moses Hess and let's say the end of the 19th century, even if there hadn't yet been very much in the way of immigration to Palestine before 1900, but there had been, of course, a certain increase even in the 1880s and 90s. So I think that this revolutionary tendency splits into two different streams. One stream simply cut themselves off completely from Jewish identity, Jewish tradition, and any feeling of responsibility or involvement with the future the future life and fate of the Jewish people. But a lot of these revolutionaries are not doing that. And I think that's a very, there's a whole different stream who are more interested in Jewish renewal than in escaping or erasing the Jewish reality completely. And I think that's a very interesting dichotomy.
Yeah. Let me maybe one final question, because we want to leave some time, 15 minutes for audience Q&A. My final question is kind of maybe somewhat philosophical, I guess, but also historical. And it's this, it's like many contemporary, certainly thinkers, academics, many of whom I think would identify as the kind of Jew that you talk about coming into being as a consequence of this radical enlightenment, secular Jews. In some ways, I think they're more skeptical than you are about the value of the Enlightenment. And so following Adorno and Horkheimer, who wrote a famous book, right, kind of during World War II about what they called the dialectic of the Enlightenment, they point out that not only the gap, there's a gap between the ideals of the Enlightenment and some of the practices of the various regimes that justify themselves in terms of this, but also perhaps some of the forms of domination that we experience in the modern world are produced by this ideal of secular reason itself. And so I'm sure you're familiar with this critique, but I just thought maybe as a philosopher, I wanted to ask you, what do you, as perhaps the most preeminent, one of the most preeminent historians of the Enlightenment, and I think in some sense as an advocate of it, certainly of the radical form of it, Spinozistic version, what do you have to say in response to that kind of critique?
Well, I must say, it never really seemed to make a great deal of sense to me. I am rather mystified, I think, by Adorno and Horkheimer in a way. I wonder just how cogent and logical their arguments are. Of course, the development of modern science and technology gives all sorts of new aids that we're seeing today, not least in the Ukraine, or all sorts of new apparatus, making all kinds of new apparatus available to tyranny and despotism and all kinds of other bad things. But I can't quite see what that has to do with enlightenment, which is Enlightenment is not about, I mean, it is very closely connected to the scientific revolution and to the modernization of technology and the promotion of modern technology. But enlightenment, strictly speaking, whether you're, and this is why I see it as one movement, even though it's got two main streams of moderate and radical enlightenment, but all enlightenment is primarily devoted to improvements that will bring about the greater happiness of mankind. That's the point of it. And if it's not concerned with improvements that either do or at least are argued to lead to a happier mankind, I can't see what it has to do with the Enlightenment. So I think all Enlightenment measures are meant to produce a more tolerant, a more inclusive, a freer, a less despotic, an educationally broadened society. That's the point of the Enlightenment. The Enlightenment is about improvements. And so this dark vision of Adorno and Horkheimer, I'm afraid, just never has made a great deal of sense to me.
Okay. Let's turn things over. I want the audience to have a chance. So if you have any questions, maybe you can type it into the chat here. So here, let's start with the last one, maybe, from an anonymous attendee. In your opinion, Jonathan, did Marx interpret Spinoza's conception of God correctly? Was his account of the world actually materialistic? Spinoza's, presumably. Furthermore, how does this materialistic account of God and the world transition into Marxism that's more similar to how it exists in modernity? And how, when and how does the concept of social class become incorporated into Spinoza's ideas?
Now, that's a very good question in a number of ways. And I should begin, I think, by saying that the Spinoza is connected in all kinds of ways with this radical enlightenment tendency. I don't think it was inspired by Spinoza individually or as a person. I should go back to the beginning and say just as the rabbis were dealing with a group. I think that the radical enlightenment began with a group of people in a circle around Spinoza, though he wasn't necessarily the leader right at the beginning, that were emerging in the 1650s, 1660s, and 1670s. And this group were very opposed to the existing setup, legally, religiously, educationally, and so on. And some of them are much more overtly anti-Christian, actually, than Spinoza is. Just bring in at this point the example of Adrian Korbach, who was one of this circle and a friend of Spinoza, who makes a very interesting comment about the Sabbatai Svi episode. Spinoza scholars often say they're extremely disappointed that we never found, if there was an answer, and it's what Spinoza's answer to a letter from Henry Oldenburg saying, what do you think about the Sabbatai Svi frenzy in Eastern Europe and the Near East? And we don't know what Spinoza's answer was. But his friend Korbach does answer this question, and probably, I'm sure he asked Spinoza about it, and they had a discussion about it. So I believe this is, that can't be proven, but I believe this is actually Spinoza's answer. In his suppressed book, it was banned and destroyed, and only finally edited in the late 20th century. Korbach's book is called Ein Licht schenende in dunklen Plätzen, a light shining in dark places. He says he's not unsympathetic to the Jews wanting everything to change and to have a better world. But if they think this is going to be brought about by miracles and what he calls tricks, the tricks of a messiah, then he's afraid that that's not going to work and it isn't going to happen that way. So if they want this liberation that the Jews are talking about in Eastern Europe, then they better look for a more rational philosophical way of getting there. So this is, if you like, that is a remark in 1668, which is amazingly prescient, I think, of some of the things to come. Now, of course, Spinoza's view is that God and nature are the same. Does that make his view of God the same as Marx's? Well, that immediately creates problems, I think, for historians of philosophy and for philosophers, because the question of in what sense Spinoza can be called a materialist and in what sense Spinoza can be called an atheist is answered differently by different scholars and is a complicated question. But I would say, to me, it seems that that Spinoza's monism can be called a form of materialism. And in that sense, it is quite close to Marx. But I should make it very clear at this point that what I've argued in the book is that some of the later Jewish revolutionaries see a very clear lineage between Spinoza's philosophy and their thinking. That's particularly true, I think, of Heinrich Heine and Moses Hess, but it's true also of a number of others. Whereas others, that it's possible to see such a lineage to a limited extent, even in the case of Marx, because the young Marx, when he wasn't interested in socialism, when he wasn't interested in economics, he was a democratic, radical and revolutionary, very critical of the setup in Germany, very critical of the German legal system, universities, everything, but not economic issues. He wasn't interested in that yet. Very critical of Jewish life and Jewish society too. When he, for example, was preparing for his doctoral oral examination, he filled this famous notebook with extracts from the Tractatus Theologico Politicus and from Spinoza's correspondence. So we know that Marx had a certain acquaintance with Spinoza's thought, that he was familiar with it, and that it's arguable that some of the comments that the young Marx makes about the need for a democratic society, for example, are echoing points made by Spinoza, although that is debatable, but I would say that they are. But that, in any case, that's completely erased by the transformation of Marx in 1844, 1845, when he's in his late 20s. into a completely different kind of revolutionary, a socialist revolutionary, who then goes on to develop an economic theory of class warfare, which I don't think has got anything actually to do with Spinoza, but neither does it have anything to do with the radical Enlightenment or the story that I'm focusing on in this book, which only goes down to the young Marx and the 1848 revolutions. So I'm stopping in the middle of the 18th century. Well, not as regards setting the wider scene a bit, but I deliberately wanted to focus on the early stages and not get into a discussion of Marxism, because so many others have written about that and so much has been said about that in the past.
I want to ask a question the next one by Joella Werlin asks, did any of the influential Jewish thinkers in the Caribbean or South America and Suriname write about slavery or recommend action in regard to slavery? And that occurred to me as well, because I heard a wonderful talk last year where the speaker wanted us to imagine you're sitting in one of these plantations in Suriname and you're reciting the Passover, Haggadah, the story of liberation, while your slaves are serving you at dinner. How can you deal with that kind of performative contradiction as a Jew? And I think that's an important question to think about, the kind of enlightenment that Jews in that period, or how they were thinking about that problem. Did it just not occur to them, or what was going on?
No, it certainly occurred to them. And I think it is a major issue in their thinking. I've talked about this a bit in the book. You mentioned before David Nasi, who's probably the most important of the Caribbean Jewish enlighteners. And he's very emphatic about the need for social equality of all groups. And he's obviously aware of the fact that there's a contradiction here between the policies of the revolutionary Dutch state that was set up in 1795, which was called the Batavian Republic, which, unlike you mentioned before, Michael, that the French Revolution ended slavery and emancipated the slaves in the French Caribbean. So that's the point at which the slaves in Haiti were set free. But this didn't happen in the Dutch colonies, and they didn't do anything along those lines. And I think Nasi is quite obviously embarrassed by this and talks about slavery issues. He wrote two or three significant texts, one of which is a history of Suriname. And in that history, he criticizes what he sees as particularly severe forms of slavery. For example, the French colonial slave code, the Code Noir, he says is a Code Noir in more senses than one, and he attacks that quite vehemently. But he doesn't really get onto the issue of the need to abolish slavery. He seems to be embarrassed by it. But there are other Sephardic Jews, or other Jews, I should say, in the Caribbean, who, and we know of at least one figure who was prepared to risk his own life for this, Isaac Sasportas. I wish I was able to find out more about him. Not much is known about him, except I've given him a few pages. Perhaps you remember those few pages, Michael. His family came from Curaçao, but he was brought up in the north of Haiti, actually. He was very sympathetic. He was a tremendous enthusiast for the French Revolution. His name was Isaac Sasportas. He was a descendant, actually, of the famous rabbi Sasportas, who opposed the Sabbatian movement in the 1660s in Holland. He was a distant descendant. And he was certainly brought up in a Jewish milieu. He had family members in Charleston, by the way. So I believe, if I remember rightly, he actually spent a period in South Carolina. Anyway, he was very much supportive of the French Revolution in the Caribbean. And he devised a conspiracy which was supported by the one of the last French colonial governors in Haiti, who only controlled part of Haiti because Toussaint Louverture had taken over the interior of Haiti by that time, which was meant to support the French Revolution in the Caribbean, and which was promising the end of slavery for all the black slaves in the Caribbean by striking a heavy blow at the British, which this Isaac Sasportas proposed to do by by renewing the revolt of the runaway slaves, the Maroons, in the mountains of Jamaica. And he knew Jamaica, and he went to Jamaica to make contact with these Maroons, which he did, and then he went back to Haiti, and then in Curaçao. He was thrown out of Curaçao for his pro-French revolution plotting. And then when the arrangements were made, and there was actually a mostly black army prepared in Haiti, or military force, which was going to be shipped over to Jamaica the moment the Maroons rose up in revolt again. And at that point, Sespaters went back to Jamaica. It was actually Toussaint Louverture who gave him away to the British authorities for his own reasons. I won't go into that now. But the British knew he was coming and arrested him. He was tried in Kingston, Jamaica. And then they wanted to make an exhibition of him to discourage others from supporting the French Revolution in this way. And Isaac Sespaters was hanged for trying to emancipate the slaves and for supporting the French Revolution by the British. And his last, as they were stringing him up, these last words were, "Vive la République."
Well, I think on that note, it's probably time to end. That's a fantastic way to end. And I want to thank you, Jonathan, for coming back to the University of Washington and sharing with us this wonderful book. I think this is just, to me, just touching the surface of the riches historically, but also intellectually, philosophically, that you can find in this text. I would encourage everyone to go out and buy it, of course. The University, and you know, it's good for the University of Washington Press as well. But thank you for writing it, and thanks for coming. And I really enjoyed the chance to look again at the text and to talk to you about it. And I hope we have more opportunity to do that again soon.
Me too. Thank you so much, Michael, for arranging this discussion and for leading a large part of it. I've really enjoyed it, and I feel very appreciative. Thank you so much.
Great. Thanks, everyone at the University of Washington.
And thanks to all. Yes, and thanks to all the audience and for the questions, but just for listening. Thank you very much. Much appreciated. Yeah.